It's a very nice crowd and very rich, I hope. This wonderful, wonderful theatre in Finsbury Park, and it doesn't get any public money at all, so it's dependent on the charity of keen theatre goers, and there'll be a lot here tonight, so I'm very happy.
What is the course close to your heart, Ian?
Well, any theatre's close to my heart, but it's a new theatre. It's helping to revive Finsbury Park, I'm told. There's some new restaurants opening up round the theatre. It's obviously very popular with the locals. And they've had a fantastic success rate. I mean, they've put on some really, really good shows. So another theatre thriving in London is good news.
You've had quite a busy day, haven't you, today, sir?
I've been in ancient Greece. I've been helping to read the Odyssey. That's for another theatre, the Almeida Theatre, another London small. It was good. It was a bit frightening. It was also in a town hall, and we're in another town hall here. So I think it would be lovely if every young person were taken to the theatre after they've seen a pantomime, discover that there's all sorts of other theatre awaiting them. Not that everyone needs to fall in love with the theatre, but an awful lot do, and it's a wonderful enrichment of your life, which is with you, all the way through. So, I don't feel that young people are unaware of the theatre. There's a lot of it about, and there's an increasing attempt to make it available, cheap prices, and that's very good. That's what the park does. They have very cheap prices for young people. I've got to go and do my job now.
I met Jez Bond, who runs the Park Theatre, and I think he's a really go-get-em sort of lad. He's transformed the place. The park's really thriving, and he's got great vision, and I just want to support him. Yeah. It's got beautiful rehearsal rooms. There's a really busy bar. You know, the restaurant's lovely and sort of throbbing, and they do really good work there. Lots of stuff's going into the West End, so I think it's the place to be at the moment. For young people who've never seen a play before, I would say come and see a pantomime, because if it's done really well, if it's a good one, I think it can hook you for life, because they're wonderful fairy stories, and if they're done well, I think they can be really magical. And that's the first kind of experience I had as a child, going to a pantomime, and I'm still doing it, so hopefully it will just bring lots of children in, yeah. The Park Theatre, as I feel, has made it possible for lots of new plays, lots of new work to go into the West End. So in a way, it's a kind of sort of thriving place to start things off, and then they can grow like a mushroom and get bigger and bigger. And I think Jez is really good at that. He takes chances. He brings in lots of good actors, that want to work, with younger people and do different things. And I think that's the way the theatre has to be. I think it's got to forge ahead and appeal to the younger people, otherwise it will die. There's nothing like live. I mean, the wonderful thing is television is fantastic. I love it, and so is film, because you get the opportunity to do it right. But in the theatre, once you go on that stage, it's yours. There's no net. If the set falls down in the middle of your big monologue, you have to deal with it there and then. So it's very exciting. You get an adrenaline rush. And I think if you create magic, you can really move audiences to tears, and you can make them laugh, and you make them think, and maybe go away with a different attitude to what's going on in the world, and different political views, and it's really important.
You talked there about some of the unpredictable things that happen in live theatre. Have you experienced any of those moments yourself?
Oh, yes. I've had a few close shaves, where the iron came in a little bit too soon and a little bit too close, and some of us nearly lost our noses. That's happened. I also had an iron walkway that and it was partly my fault, to be fair. I was talking to someone and they let the grid go, and I was very lucky. Somebody happened to be standing very close to me and pulled me out of the way. So it can be a very dangerous place if you've not got your wits about you. You have to concentrate. So I would say that to all would-be young performers, it's not a place for larking about. It's a place for doing your art. I've worked in a lot of theatres where people have told me that there are ghosts, and some of the actors have said that maybe they saw something up in the box there. Personally, I've never seen a ghost. I've never had any experiences of that kind. But I don't know whether I believe or disbelieve. I mean, for me, I suppose seeing is believing, and I think when logically, when something happens to you, then obviously you're much more apt to believe in it. But if it hasn't happened to you, then you still have an open mind. But as yet, nothing's happened. Yeah, it is competitive. Of course it is. Everybody, you know, wants to do their best and wants to be seen. But really, for me, the best of theatre is that it's a company thing. And for me, I'm happiest, you know, when I'm playing roles and I have a really good team around me. I love that. I love the fact that you've got people around you that are really fantastic.
It's theatre, and it's a lovely theatre, and it's successful theatre, and it needs our support and money and everything it does so far seems to have been wonderful, and it's local, it's vibrant, it's going to go global. So, well, it's very interesting that the first time youngsters go to the theatre, particularly anything to do with Shakespeare, it's a very, very important time, that first visit, because the theatre has so much to offer them, but these days they've got so many alternatives. There's so much else going on in their hands 24/7. So the theatre has got in some way to drag their attention up from the palms of their hands outwards, you know, because they seem to be very insular. It's all going on in here, but they've got to learn, and we've got to teach them. I mean, it's up to us.
What was the theatre experience that gave you the bug?
Oh, I think it was an over-the-top performance when I was very young. I must have been about 10. Donald Wolfit playing Lear and Tamburlaine at, I think it was, the King's Theatre, Hammersmith. And he was a big actor laddie who tore the scenery apart and was wonderful. And I thought, that's for me.
We get a new series soon? What are we thinking, James?
Well, I think we're going to do a big special. We're going to record it this Christmas.
Any special guest appearance?
Yeah. That I don't know. It's all deep, deep secret. I don't know what the plot is, what the words are going to be. Nothing about it. So.
My neighbour, the theatre is my neighbour, I'm an ambassador as well, and yeah, it's been 2 years, and in the last 2 years we've seen it really grow. I've been in Crouch End for quite a long time, for about 15 years now, and we've never had anything quite so buzzy just suddenly arrive and kind of take over. Theatre generally is really expensive, I think, but the Park Theatre is affordable, which I really love, and what they do with community is really important, I think. And some of the work they've produced, well, pretty much all the work they've produced has been pretty top notch. So it's now competing with the other theatres, the big theatres that have always had that kind of credit and those reputations. So I feel very proud of it. I'm in the middle of having a bit of time off with the kids, so theatre's always sounds a little bit strange, but it feels like I'm coming home when I go and do a theatre piece. So theatre's the thing that always entices me back. As an actor, it's extremely important. I wouldn't be acting if it wasn't for theatre. When we train, we don't learn how to be in front of a camera. Well, I didn't in my day. We learned how to be on stage, and the camera, the television and film work came afterwards. So the root of all acting is theatre for me. I would say as a audience member, it's kind of formed some of my most vivid memories as a child, and the inspiration that watching theatre gave me to become an actress is just invaluable. So I just think I take my daughter as much as we can afford, as much as, you know, is possible with our time, and she adores it. So I think it's very important.
What's the special significance of particularly local theatre venues like Park Theatre?
Well, just what they do for the community. There are an awful lot of children, teenagers in our area that probably wouldn't go to the theatre if they didn't have the support from Park Theatre. So if you just had, you know, the theatres in the West End, it's more of an effort, it's more of a trip, it's more expensive. If you've got some, you know, like we have just up the road, it's perfect. Perfect for kids growing up.
Is your daughter thinking about following you into the acting profession?
I don't know. I feel a bit like I would kind of love it. which sounds, most people say, oh no, please don't, but it would be quite hypocritical of me to say go and do something like be a doctor or a lawyer, because I've had a brilliant career and I've really loved it, and the joy you get from it, I would understand why she wants to do it. It's just you want to protect them from the rejection, really. That's the main thing.
Why is the Park Theatre such an important cause for you? What made you want to become an ambassador?
I got involved really, really early on when it was still being built. In fact, yeah, before it had been built. And I'm a local to the theatre, and I was just so thrilled that someone was getting it together to do something for that area, because I think it's been long neglected. And I have been completely bowled over with what Jez and the team have come up with, not just the building itself, but the programming and the vibe that they've created, the work that they've produced. It's kind of going from strength to strength. It's just amazing to have a theatre, you know, so fully formed, just appear on the scene like that. So it's great. How to encapsulate the value of live theatre in a brief thing? For me, just hearing stories, seeing humanity represented on stage, you know, questions being asked, being taken out of your comfort zone, being taken out of your, you know, familiarity, and being presented with different lives, different scenarios, you know, I don't know, but live theatre, there's nothing like it. It's really hard to explain. I just love it. I've got the bug. I mean, this year alone, I've seen some astonishing performances recently. Denise Goff in People, Places and Things, Leah Williams in The Oresteia, Kate Fleetwood in Madea. I mean, I think they're all up for Best Actress, aren't they, on numerous sort of awards. It's been a really, really astonishing year. But yeah, going way back to when I was young, Victoria Hamilton in lots of things, and I saw when I was a sort of very impressionable age, and she was like my hero, and yeah, loads of people. We're blessed in this country. It's such a great pool of talent.
What are you going on to next yourself?
I'm doing a series in the new year, filmed in Northern Ireland, so 3 months.
Lord of the Rings, Game of Thrones?
No, it's not actually. It's a new BBC Northern Ireland series, filmed sort of set around Loch Ness during the war. So, yeah, it'll be lovely.
Who will you be working with?
I don't know yet. I know Adrian Shergold is a director is attached, and I don't know the rest of the cast. It'll be a mixture of Irish and American mainly.
I'm thrilled to be here supporting the Park Theatre. I've been aware of it actually pretty much since it opened. I think Jez Bond does an extraordinary job of finding not only brilliant new work, but wonderful plays that haven't been seen for a while. I first came to see Oliver Cotton's play. My husband and son appeared in Gathered Leaves, which is a wonderful new piece of work. And I think it's thrilling that there's a new, exciting, vibrant theatre. That's why I'm here. The youngsters will absolutely engage. And the other brilliant thing that they've done is they've made the actual building so buzzy. You know, the bar and the food, and it's got such a good vibe. I just think it's wonderful, and I wish them the very, very best.
Well, it's a playpen, isn't it? We've got to support live theatre. It's marvellous. It's a place for me to play in the dressing up box. Why would I not support it? My memory of being on that stage. Oh, well, I love it. I mean, it's a great venue. It's a bit like the Arcola. It's a bit like the Donmar Warehouse, only slightly better. I like the configuration. I like small spaces. I like intimate spaces. I like being where the audience is. I like the audience going out looking like they've been sat in a wind tunnel for 3 hours. Our theatre was dying when I joined in 1967. Yeah, it's always dying on its arse. But I don't think people realise what the power of theatre is. You know, you can say things more immediately. And I love the fact that you can sit in a room with a few hundred people that you don't know and have an exchange of energy, an exchange of ideas. And sounds a bit like my front room, actually.
It's an important night tonight.
Yeah, it's great to raise money. It's not only celebrating, it's raising money for the thing, and that's what we need, yeah. Being as how they don't pay us. I don't mind what class people come from. You know, if you're good, you're good. doesn't matter where you come from. But I do think there is a case to be made that working class people or underclass people don't get the same opportunities now as they used to. And a lot of that's down to the fact that they don't get subsidies anymore, you know, and we can blame the last government for that. In fact, the play I did there is going on tour next year, and it's going to New York.
Right.
Yeah.
New York, where, on Broadway?
Off Broadway.
Oh, very good.
In fact, it'll probably be so off Broadway, it'll be in Canada. I had a great part. I was monosyllabic, had to sit down, chain smoke, and eat a cheese sandwich. Perfect for me. I'm always playing myself. Yeah, I only do the one performance, it covers everything. I'm doing panto next with my son, playing Ugly Sisters, mainly because it's all shades of wrong, cross-dressing with your children over the festive period. But don't tell social services, that's all I can say. I should be doing that in Richmond, and then I'm going out on tour in the play that I did with the Park Theatre.
Still in its infancy, really, but it's doing brilliantly well, puts on brilliant plays, and it's great that it's a new theatre. We want new theatres, you know, because so many theatres have closed in the past, and this is in North London, Finsbury Park, and it's amazing, it's just doing so well. Fringe theatres, smaller theatres are springing up, and that's good, and that's what we want, because we've lost so many regional theatres, and that's the sad thing. So the more theatres we can encourage, and the more theatres that are opening, and young people to come to the theatre, because it worries me that sometimes you tend to get in a lot of theatres, everyone's got grey hair, you know, and you think, what's going to happen in 20, 30, 40 years' time? But at the Finsbury Park Theatre, there seems to be a lot of young people are interested, so that's great.
What is the magic of live theatre? What is the value of live theatre?
Well, it's like nothing else. It's like nothing else. Television is great and film is great, of course. Well, one you know, doesn't want to knock that, but live performances, because they're different, they're exciting. Audiences are experiencing this thing all together, and audiences are important. We must never lose live theatre.
What's the most embarrassing thing that's ever happened to you on stage?
Embarrassing? Well, I was part of it. Linda Bellungen's skirt fell off during a performance and she had no underwear on. And if Linda were here today, she would be laughing along with me. And there was a good reason for that, because in the previous scene she had to be semi-naked up against a frosted glass door of a bathroom. And then she had to dress very, very quickly and come out and do this scene. And she hadn't hooked her skirt properly and it fell off. And it was one of the funniest moments ever. I mean, the audience at first went, is that supposed to be in it? No, it can't be. And the laughter just built. And as actors, when the curtain came down, we were just crying and we were just all hugging each other. It was a very, very funny moment.
Yes, we need, more theatres, if anything. And it's such a lovely one. Having seen work there and work there, it's wonderful. I really, really loved it. And it does so well. It's remarkable. So it needs to be looked after and supported, because it's just the perfect place for an interesting new play, you know, that might not find a home anywhere else. And new writing is what theatre should all be about, I think. Well, the West End, inevitably now, it is so expensive to put on a play in the West End that you have to fill it with coach parties, tourists, obviously, which we all need desperately. But for a new, interesting, but possibly not obviously commercial play, you have to find this sort of local theatre, and you have to get a local audience that is loyal and supports it and comes regularly. That's how it all works. The West End is such a different thing. I mean, I love working in the West End, but I enjoy more working in a local theatre like this, and where people come regularly and you get to know them and they get to know the theatre, and there's a lovely cafe, I'm sure you know, and it's got a great atmosphere, so we need more of them.
What's been your most embarrassing moment on stage?
Like everybody, it's when you can't quite remember what you should be saying next, and I think on the whole I've managed to cover it up, hopefully, but I've had some horrible moments. Yeah, I mean, it's just awful when you sort of feel the floor go beneath your feet and you cannot think what comes next. And I have once been in one of those terrible things which we call a loop, where there are two bits of a scene that are very similar, and you think you're in one bit and actually you're in the first one, and you find you can go round again. You know, you actually find you're coming round and you can't think, where do I break it, you know? But audiences never seem to notice, you know?
I know that the National's done wonderful things with the Travel X, with the £10 tickets and everything else. Even I can't afford to get to West End. It's crazy. It's crazy. You're looking 60, 70, 80 quid a ticket. But the park's great because it's hopefully affordable. And a lot of locals come. I know a lot of the locals drink in there. And I was in there one afternoon. It's a whole pile of people in Arsenal shirt. Said, have you been to see the play? And said, no, we've been to see the football. I said, come and see the play. Next week, they came to see the play, which was wonderful. I'm doing a thing called The Crown for Netflix, playing Lord Mountbatten at the moment. It's a big 10-hour piece for Netflix about the royal family from about 1947 to the early 50s.
Till his death?
Till his death? No, he was 79 when he died. I'm far too young to pass to 79 just yet. But no, this is just till 1953. Really talk to Prince Charles about it, shouldn't I? Because I know they were great chums, but no. I just read up, and but he was obviously a very brave man. Because whenever I put the gear on, I have medals not only here, but then they also cantilever out slightly.
That Beauty and the Beast soundtrack, still playing in the household?
Yes. In fact, I just worked with one of the guys who was doing it, and they say they're recording it in a few weeks' time, and we should all go down. So I just did a silly thing called Gallivant for NBC, and it's the same musical director for that. So yeah, it's all go around our house at the moment.
It's more than you can imagine. It's been such an extraordinary and profound part of my life here, and I feel, you know, completely embraced by the theatre community and by the audience, and I've always wanted to work in theatre here, and I have been, and I seem to be able to get to and to mix it in with everything else that I do, and that's extremely important to me. The night that I saw the show and he did speak out about the refugees, I was incredibly moved by what he said, and he referenced a poem which was incredibly moving. I think the audience on the whole was moved into action, not just that night, but I got the sense in general people were approving of his attempt to speak out about a situation that is at this moment dire in our present world, and I don't believe, given the amount of attention, that it really deserves.
Exciting 2016, the X-Files are back. We want
yes,
to know,
I know
what we can expect.
I wish I could tell you. It'll be scary. I hope it will be good. There'll be some laughs. And I think overall, even though I haven't seen any of it, I'm most pleased with the fact that it feels like what we used to deliver. And that's kind of what the audience and the fans seem to want. So I think we've accomplished that. So hopefully it will be successful.
Will there be aliens in it?
Will there be aliens in it? No aliens. No aliens this year, sorry.
I guess, I mean, Gillian, you've yeah. obviously done such a range of work since you previously worked on the show. I'm curious, yeah. Were you apprehensive in any way about going back to such an iconic character that defined so much of the early part of your career?
No, not really apprehensive. I actually got kind of excited about it and continued to be excited about it while we were doing it. I don't think I ever had the thought, oh no, I'm going backwards. But thanks for putting that in my head. From now on, that's what I'll think about. I'll be apprehensive about it.
Shouldn't be.